traveling through hyperspacing like dust and crops, boy. Without precise calculations, we'd fly right through a star or bounce too close to a supernova and then end your trip real quick, wouldn't we?
By the way, I did not have time to put in all of the coordinates when we jumped.
We're not going to Dakar?
No. We will either be relatively close or unfathomable light years away.
Niku, are you serious? You have no idea where we're going.
What up everyone, it's Kirtan Singh here and I'm back with a brand new video. So today, I'm finally talking about Star Wars Resistance. As you can tell from the title itself and the cold open, I really hate this show. It's a terrible show both, you know, if you want to say the excuse that it's for kids. It's a pretty bad show for kids as well, you know. You can check out the video where I talked about that itself by clicking on the card on the screen here. So let's get into the series itself, and before I continue, I'm just going to say that, no, I did not only just watch this show, I saw this show as it was being released, but at the time, didn't really want to or chose not to make a weekly episode review. But now looking back, I wish I did, because I have so many notes on this show itself, and so many that I can't go through them all, so I have them on my laptop here, hoping that I can at least skim through it as I do this and pick up on certain things I want to talk about. But for the sake of this video, I'm going to record the screen so I can put up my notes on the side here. And then I'm just going to let that play through for a little bit so you can see all the notes I have. You can pause it where you want and then you can see specific things I might have missed out on. It goes in chronological order from episode 1 all the way to whatever episode 20 or 22, however many episodes there were. So with that all said and done, I hopefully you've gone through the notes if you wanted to, but let's talk about Star Wars Resistance. Normally when a review happens, you would talk about the story itself for this show, but I'm honestly just going to pick this show apart. I'm going to talk about the story, I'm going to talk about the characters, I'm going to talk about the animation, and I'm not going to do it in any specific order. I'm just going to bounce around, I've got notes up here. I try to write as much of a script as I could, but there are so many things I have written down that I just can't follow a script for this. So I'm going to improvise, I'm going to miss out on a few things, but like I said earlier, check out the notes which I put on screen earlier to see what I've missed out on. So let's start by talking about the animation. I personally love the animation style. I think it's really cool and it's very different to the Clone Wars and Rebels. I still think the Clone Wars animation, the original Clone Wars animation, is the best for in the later seasons, I should say, sorry, because Clone Wars movie was not very well animated at times. But to say that, the animation looks amazing when water splashes up. It looks very beautiful and I really love it. And certain textures look really nice. But some characters, for example, Princess Leia or General Organa, as she is in this show, they're just terrible. Like, she doesn't look like Princess Leia, General Organa. She doesn't even sound like General Organa. When she talks, I'm like, who is this? Why did they even get this person to voice this character? Because it's so terrible. I can't imagine who said, you know what, that's all right, let's greenlight it. I'm going to move on to the characters because really that's where everything really lies, because the show feels like it's trying to be very character driven because it has so many episodes. I'd say 90% of the episode explores different characters and different interactions, and essentially it feels like filler for the most part. I'd say only about 3 or 4 episodes actually feel like they're pushing the story forward and going into an interesting direction, and most of those involve Poe Dameron or the First Order actually doing something. So regarding the characters, there are too many to go over, so I will talk about a select few. Let's talk about Kaz, the obvious main character, and he is shit. I really wish he would get shot and just die early on, because he's way too annoying. He doesn't feel like he's a New Republic fighter, and with that said, he's not even that great of a Republic fighter. In the first scene, we see him take down and actually shoot this red stormtrooper who's in this red TIE fighter and everything, and Poe Dameron compliments him on it, and it doesn't make sense at all, because what he did, the trick he did, was not impressive at all. It wasn't visually impressive, it wasn't stylistically impressive, I should say, and I just really wasn't impressed by it at all. And then you have how he really just suddenly goes from a real clumsy idiot, someone who's just making all these mistakes, and then he just suddenly becomes a little bit more competent. He's not even fully competent by the end of the show, I guess to an extent he is, but there's no character development. This show takes place over a course of several months, but when you're watching this show, it doesn't feel like that. It feels like episodic adventures that take place across, you know, time, but it doesn't feel like any of the characters are actually going anywhere, which is why, even though it kind of feels like time's progressing, it doesn't feel like it is, because none of the characters are really changing. The only character which I believe really changes a lot is Tam, and that's only because she goes from being on the good side onto joining the First Order, and no one else really undergoes much of a change like that. And I'm just going to quickly mention that Captain Dozer, I'm not going to talk much about his character because there's not much to talk about. He essentially runs the Colossus, the fueling station, and while he doesn't really do much in the story itself except for despise the First Order for some reason, we find out that he was an ex-Imperial, and it's like teasing this whole adventure that he's going to go on, that he's going to do something impressive, or that something's going to be revealed, considering that Yeager is an ex-rebellion fighter. And then we get backstory for Yeager, we don't get anything for Captain Dozer and whatnot, and it eventuates into nothing. So you tease us with what is actually pretty interesting, the fact that Captain Dozer is an ex-Imperial, and then he could be the spy or whatnot, but, you know, he doesn't end up being anything regarding the ex-Imperial uniform. Going back to Kaz, he has this really weird relationship with Sonara. She's this alien, she's a female, she's a pirate, and then, you know, he saves her at one point, and then she, like, tricks him into becoming his friend, and she, like, gives information to the pirates so they can attack the Colossus and whatnot, but then she eventually becomes friends with him and Tam and whatnot, and Kaz is flirting with her constantly, and it feels like a 5-year-old trying to impress a 12-year-old. Like, you know that they both feel like they're idiots. Like, Sonara's a little more competent than Kaz. Well, a lot more competent, I should say. But her character-wise, I don't care about her any more than I do care about Kaz. And Kaz, I don't care about at all. I said he should die. I was really hoping at one point he's jumping across these, like, gaps and stuff. He's getting shot by stormtroopers. And I'm like, please fall over. Come on, Kaz. Just go. I don't want you in this show anymore because you're damn annoying. You're a sidekick. You're not a main character, you're clumsy as hell, and you're just... Why did they put this romantic relationship in there? Because it's cringy as hell. You get one or two funny moments, but that's because I'm laughing at Kaz. Not laughing with him, not laughing with Sonara, not laughing with the show. I'm laughing at the show, okay? I'm laughing at this Star Wars show. That's how bad this Star Wars show is. You know, speaking about how Kaz is like a sidekick, he really does feel like one, and it feels like this show should follow Poe Dameron. It's called Star Wars Resistance, yet we're following a member of the Resistance who only just became a member of the Resistance, isn't trained to be a spy, yet has the job of being a spy and trying to capture and figure out who another spy is. What? Just make Poe the main character, because the show was at its best when Poe was in it, when the First Order was doing something. You know, Poe's in the show, he has a really funny moment when he kills one of those salacious crumb creatures, and it's really funny, the face he makes and everything is really good. But he's barely in the show, and I really want him to be the main character. The show, like The Force Awakens, also has Poe and BB-8 have a really good relationship. I did forget to mention that BB-8 is in this show, and he's always with Kaz. But the thing is that Poe and BB-8, they're apparently really good friends, they're best friends and stuff. But in the movies, and in this show, Poe is barely with BB-8. For, I'd say, 90% of this series, of this season, Poe and BB-8 are separated. BB-8 is with Kaz. Then in The Force Awakens, which takes place almost immediately, or at the same time at the end of this season, BB-8 is pretty much always with Rey. And then in The Last Jedi, which takes place immediately after The Force Awakens, BB-8 is pretty much always with Finn. So throughout all the forms of media I've seen, I don't know about the books and comics, but throughout this like visual media, BB-8 and Poe don't have much of a relationship at all because BB-8 is always with someone else. One interesting thing is that they're having this, the explosion of the New Republic displayed on screen for Stormtroopers to see, and Kaz and Tora, I think that's her name. They view the show as well. Not the show. They view the explosion, the destruction happening. And, you know, Kaz is like, oh no, my dad, my family, they're there. That's my home world. I don't care. You know, like, I didn't care for you. You didn't have any relationship with your family or Hosni and Prime. I don't care for your loss, okay? I had more emotion seeing these random people in The Force Awakens get blown up by Starkiller Base than watching your reaction to your home planet and possibly your family dying. So, you know, it was a really shitty moment. Alright, so now I'm just going to talk about random moments here and there which I really didn't like or I did like. Like I said earlier, pretty much everything with The First Order, for the most part, it's pretty good. I don't get and I don't like how the red stormtrooper in the red TIE fighter died so easily. I also don't like how Captain Phasma was rarely used, because I feel like if this was a type of show that had Poe Dameron as the main character, you could have had a side story or two stories happening at the same time. One with Captain Phasma and then one with Poe Dameron. An interesting thing that Yiga says is that the average person doesn't know about the Resistance, which is very interesting because I thought the Resistance were very open with their whole recruiting system, and people knew that the New Republic existed, but they didn't have a military, that a strong military at that, and then that's why the Resistance existed, to counter the First Order, because people clearly know about the First Order, because no one's really surprised when they come to the Colossus and everything happens. Why do they not know about the Resistance and whatnot? They also seem to think that the Jedi are a myth. No one really believes in the Jedi. No one really knows what happened with the Empire, with the Death Stars and everything. People think stormtroopers are just, you know, remnants or like wannabes of the original stormtroopers. And it doesn't make any sense at all. This happened, this series takes place 30 years, less than 30 years, before, after the event, sorry, of Return of the Jedi. So the Empire was destroyed, we'll say, just under 30 years ago. Luke's new Jedi Order just ended 10 years ago, maybe less, we don't know. So it's been 10 to 25 years since the Emperor, since Death Star, since the Jedi. Yet people seem to have forgotten about it. Like, I get this is a whole huge universe, bunch of worlds and bunch of planets, and we're just, you know, right now in our current Earth, we're just Earth, you know, so we can easily remember events that have happened a few hundred years ago, or even things that have happened 10 to 20 years ago, and, you know, they're in space, so they might not all know about certain things, but you're also in space where you can send all these transmissions, holograms, and everything. Surely people can easily remember the destruction of Alderaan, the Death Star blowing up Jeddah, the Death Star exploding twice, the whole Battle of Endor, the Jedi? How do people not remember the Jedi? Surely Coruscant, which is actually mentioned in this show, Coruscant still has the Jedi Temple. Surely they still have some sort of archives here and there, some sort of memory of the Jedi, not necessarily on Coruscant, but in other areas as well. And it just doesn't make sense why characters don't seem to remember these things. At the start of the series, we see that carnivorous creatures live in the water and whatnot. Yet later in the show, we see these hermit-like turtle characters. They fall into the water and they're fine, they're safe, they're like waving and stuff. But the thing is, I thought there were carnivorous creatures in the water and people were afraid to get chucked off the Colossus. You know, people just don't go swimming in the water because it's dangerous, yet these turtles are just swimming there. You also see Sonara when she escapes in that escape pod in the water. She escapes through the water, no creatures at all except for this giant kraken thing, which came in an episode with Niku, who is so damn annoying. Like, I liked the character in like the first 2-3 episodes. After that, I was way too annoyed by him. He didn't suit the show at all. He came off as annoying way too often and was just out of place. So in one episode, there's this little creature which they find. Niku really adores him and takes care of him. And it turns out that this kraken-like monster, it's actually his child or its child or whatever. So it comes and attacks the Colossus and people think that it wants to eat that little creature thing, so then they want to give it up. But Niku loves it, doesn't want to give it up. So then he chooses to keep the pet and sacrifice everyone on the station just so he can keep the pet safe, instead of giving the pet away, even if it's about to eat it, which is a really, really ridiculous thing to think of considering how many creatures are actually in the ocean, except when I just said that there aren't any when we see it, but people are afraid to go in. It doesn't make sense. And For some reason, there are no repercussions to him not wanting to give up this creature and sacrifice everyone else. No one ever hates him for it, being like, you chose this little creature that you barely knew over everyone on this station. Nothing like that happens. And the Kraken, which is shown as Sonara escapes in the escape pod, never comes back. So what was the point of that episode? Because it made me hate Neeku. It made everyone else should hate Neeku. And then it was pointless because none of the Kraken creature ever came back to fight against the First Order or anything. Okay, so what else do we have? We have Elijah Wood's character. I cannot remember his name. He's this white-haired kid. And he comes off in like episode 5 or something. And he's like this mini antagonist that Kaz has to overcome and then show the right way of. But in the end, Elijah Wood's character still hates Kaz. And he never comes back in the rest of the show. He's there in the background. He's like, oh, Captain Dozer, Kaz is here. That's about it. He's never really an antagonist for Kaz again. And he has no payoff. He has no, you know, setup. He has a setup, I guess. Pretty poor setup. No payoff, though. It's kind of a useless character, and I don't get why he was in the show. There's a whole hubba-hubba about the fact that Elijah Wood was, you know, voicing a character, but, you know, it amounted to nothing. When Tora and Kaz, they're going, escaping from the Citadel or the Hightower, whatever it's called, they come out through this, like, garbage chute or something, and, like, fire thing, whatever you burn stuff, whatever that is, and it's the stupidest setup ever. I get, you know, you need to give a plausible way for our heroes to actually get out of the situation, but the actual burning thing, I don't know what it's called, but the furnace or whatever, where you burn garbage and stuff, it's a bunch of lasers randomly shooting garbage that's laying on the floor. Randomly shooting. Having a bunch of lasers randomly fire at the ground, hoping to actually hit a target, you know, is complete bullshit. You know, and then you give the characters, make them able to dodge and weave their way out of it. I just don't get why that scene was actually made, apart from the fact that they couldn't think of anything else and they needed a fun, stupid action scene. And people are going to be like, oh, it's for kids, they'll enjoy it. No, shut up about that. Be practical and give me a good story and I'll enjoy it. Doesn't matter who you're making it for, make it good. Finally, we're going to talk about the flying in the show. This was heavily. It's not heavenly at all, but it was heavily promoted through all the promotions, the trailer and whatnot. We have the Aces, who are these cool ragtag group of fighters and whatnot, except that only two of them really get character development, Tora and Hype. And out of those two, I only really like Hype, because, you know, he's kind of cool and he's voiced by that guy from Scrubs, which is awesome. And the rest of them, I think, get one line each. You know, one of them might get two lines, but beyond that, they do jack all, you know? I'm sure they're in that web series or something that they have these mini episodes online or whatever, but I'm talking about this actual season itself. They do jack all. There's also that point in the show where they're running away from from an explosion, and then they're going away that way, and Kaz decides to drop down and then hide in a meteorite, which was very stupid to do because, you know, an explosion's coming this way, going down, practically, you would get caught in the explosion. Hiding behind a meteorite doesn't guarantee that you'd be protected from the explosion because, well, the meteorite could get destroyed along with you. So if anything, Poe did the most straightforward thing, which is actually going straight. And anyway, that's just me getting annoyed at that one scene. Nonetheless, the fighting in space, the whole flying thing was pretty stupid, along with the fact they did a droid swap where in midair, whatever, they let one droid come out of the pocket, the other droid come out of the pocket, and then they switch into the next each other's pockets of the ships. And it's ridiculous. You know, it's a little goofy, it's a little fun, I have no problem with goof in my show, but it's because everything else is just so bad, I hate this moment as well. I'm going to talk about the mid-season and the season finale. Firstly, the mid-season finale did not feel like a mid-season finale at all. I didn't think the characters really got left off in a place where I was like, oh, I can't wait to see what happens next. Or I left off in a place where I was like, I can see where this is going. Because like I could kind of see where it was going, because I knew they told us it would lead up to The Force Awakens. Beyond that, I wasn't like, oh yeah, Kaz is going to go this, Neeku's going to do that. Nah. There was no setup at all, because the show progresses in a way where time progresses, but the characters don't. They suddenly just change, or in some cases, don't at all. This finale itself was, you know, it was alright. Let me just go to my notes here. What do I have? We see stormtroopers get sucked out of water and, you know, suffocate and stuff. And these are the same stormtroopers which are, you know, we're meant to care for and we're meant to see as human because Finn was a stormtrooper, you know? We also see this stormtrooper that Kaz is dragging on the floor have his head knocked on stairs because Kaz is dragging him down the stairs. And it's laid off as a funny, goofy moment, Because you're being mean to a human being. What is Disney trying to do? Seriously, you keep things consistent, you know? You took the risk of making a stormtrooper human. Now you can't treat stormtroopers like ragdolls. You've got to understand that, but they don't. And then we have them reveal that the Colossus is more than just a space station or water station, whatever. It's an actual ship. They go into hyperspace and everything. And as you could tell by the cold open, this part is ridiculous because you can't not put in random coordinates into the hyperspace drive and, you know, not expect to die, you know? They don't treat it like it's a bad thing to do, as Han Solo stated in George Lucas's first ever Star Wars film. The guy who created Star Wars said that you have to be precise when you type in hyperspace coordinates. Yet Niku just put any random coordinates and it's rubbish. It doesn't make sense at all. So I don't really have much hope going into the next season of Star Wars Resistance. I'm still going to watch it because, you know, it's a Star Wars show and, you know, why not? I'll enjoy it to an extent, I should say. If anything, I'll enjoy making fun of it and, you know, being able to make videos on it. But the thing is, they need to make changes. Unlike Star Wars Rebels, which, you know, had quite a few bad moments in it, there was still that hope that there'd be something really good. And there were really good moments and episodes. And there was that hope, you know what, they can really go to places with this. And, you know, seeing how, you know, Lucasfilm and Disney, you know, respond to fan criticism, it doesn't look like the season 2 is going to change much from season 1. It doesn't look like they're going to take on any feedback. But we'll have to wait and see whether or not, you know, the Resistance ends up dying, you know, because they end up going into a supernova because of the hyperspace coordinates. But I don't know. We'll see what happens. I am looking forward to what happens with Tam, although I can for the most part guess that she will end up joining the Resistance again, because I doubt Star Wars Resistance will go so far as to have Tam die in Kaz's arm because she gives him an ultimatum and he ends up having to kill her for some reason, or anything of the sorts, but we'll see. Overall, Star Wars Resistance sucks. You know, I wouldn't even recommend it to the light-hearted Star Wars fans. I only watch it because I care enough about Star Wars to even watch the bad things. And unlike Star Wars The Clone Wars and Star Wars Rebels, the season has little to no good points, which get me excited for the following season. It's a 2 out of 10.